Okay, hello, good afternoon. Yeah, I apologize because Enric is not very British, is not sharp on time, but that's life. So Enric, well, maybe you know him, but he's a very relevant architect. He's from Barcelona. Now he is working in UTech in the University of Virginia Tech. But he's one of the most relevant here in Catalonia and sometimes around the world. So he has been doing amazing projects. He was co-founder of the association that led IAAC be created. And then during many years, he has been doing amazing projects. One of the most amazing one is this Mediatik. That is nearby. Mediatik won the best architect, best building in the world in the World Architecture Festival some years ago. But beside that, he has been always working with digital technologies. He, during some years, he was also in the theater and in the show business, but I think he's not anymore. He's in another kind of show business in architecture. And then we invited him because, as I say, he has been co-director of the Master in Advanced Architecture for several years in the self-sufficient building group. And we invite him also as part of this competition that we are running right now, Design for Biocities, because he has been many years trying to connect nature, digital technologies, and architecture. So that's why, well, as you will see, he used nature as reference and the geometry behind nature or some part of nature as a reference for some of the work that he does. And then for those that may will see the video, he has been working in the bioarchitecture, or however we can call it, during many years, and that's why today he is here with us. So thank you, Enric, for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you, Vicente. I'll stay here, so I think it's better for the cameras and everything. So what if a new Green Deal needs to emerge of a new generation of architects? What if this new Green Deal is based on the idea of biocities? And what if this new Green Deal is based on the idea of me and the idea of we? As Vicente was suggesting, yes, we have a strong portfolio. Now we are starting to see 23 years of work. I'll jump quick into some projects. The idea of indetermination is one of them. We work here in the School of Barcelona, working with Iago Conde. Iago Conde was an amazing architect teaching at the IAAC, and we were spending many, many hours with him throwing paper, and those accidents of paper were producing architecture. Accidents producing architecture. We got the best chance that was to build Vilanurbs. Vilanurbs was a project that started in the north here, about 2 hours away in Empuria Brava with a family. There we tried from melting ice, the idea of performance again, and from there digital fabrication. And this image that you see is back in 2006. So it's it was a project that was very advanced on those years, on the making. That project led us to the New York Times. And I would like to stop for a moment there, because actually the first project that was the first house, and when you are thinking about bios, no, biocities, think about even the home. The home is the living lab. The home is the first scale in which we have to operate. So a new home like Villa Bio, and we call it like this, Villa Bio, was the beginning of this attempt, starting by the section, bringing this idea of a green roof into a neighborhood. That green roof became an outdoor house. That green roof produced thermal isolation, produced an aromatic landscape. And it produced a continuity to the wild nature. So we were bringing biodiversity into the neighborhood. It's the only greenhouse, green roof in this area. And it got us the attention to the Financial Times, which made us think about, it doesn't matter if we are doing something relevant and small, but what matters today is that you do something small, but deeply.
Closer? Okay, closer.
Okay. So what matters is that you do something close, small, even, but what's really important is that you go in innovation extremely deep inside innovation. We were able to win this competition of the Media ICT in Barcelona. You know well the district, this is part of us. I mean, it's a great district, you know, it's innovation. We have smart cities, we have developed this idea of green agendas, we have developed this idea of electric mobility. But if you see the buildings there, the buildings, are still weighing 1,000 kilos per square meter. The buildings there in the skyline are buildings out of concrete structure, 900 kilos a square meter, to support a program of 350 square meter. So we are building 1,000 to support 300. As you understand, you are sitting in these chairs, and the chairs are not three times your weight, but less, right? So as architects, as you know, we are the number one cause of global warming. Buildings are the problem, but maybe buildings are the solution. In this building here, the Media ICT, we set ourselves a target of not doing 1,000 to support 300. What if we do 300 to support 300? What if the building weighs as the program, right? That's three times less, not 3%, not 30%, three times less. So the key to, I believe, biocities is the idea of lightness. Make a note about this, lightness. Structures which are extremely light that can be 70% lighter than your neighbors, therefore, 60% less foundations, therefore, 2 million euros on savings on concrete. I hope nobody's from the industry of concrete here today, tonight, because tonight is not your night, sorry. Eh? It's going to be about less concrete, more performative, but less, thinner, and lighter. So light structures, but also structures that think about distributed things. They think in a distributed matter. They're fabricated not in Germany, not in NASA, but right here in Lleida, in a factory that the third generation is making robots to be part of the fabrication process. So it is a place in which you can use digital files and the architecture is. Of the machine and not the amount of the steel. So instead of doing a project that is based on euros per kilos of steel, is based on machines and time. They work over weekends, they work the weekend. There is really low cost to those machines, and that's the complexity you get. You see the thickness of these bars? One day I invite you as a group to come to the Media ICT and give a tour to the building. I'd love to show you. You see the different thickness of every bar. The thickness is about 18 different thickness. So an engineer will calculate all to the peak of a strength, and all will have the same diameter, right? But that's not what you see in nature. That's not what you see in trees and branches. So there is 18 different diameters and 9 different thickness. By that, you reduce 25% the amount of kilos of this structure, which is about 280,000 euros. to pay higher fees in architecture and engineers is 80,000. So we are taking the money of the building, but paying higher fees and not more steel. You see where we go? Yeah? Low cost, higher fees. That's what we want. We want our knowledge to be paid. Yes? We are. Are you with me? Yes, absolutely. Another one, anybody on the steel business tonight? No concrete business, no steel business, sorry. But you know, our steel comes from Russia, so maybe it's okay to use less steel, right? This idea of international dependence. So our buildings can produce the energy they need. Our buildings can gather energy. Consumption and light, so that we get birds and nesting back to our cities. You know, a generation before us, we were, you know, when you take the highway and you see the highway with no cars and all the lights are on, excuse me, our cars have lights and you have parking lots and then you have the city lights lighting our cars. Why? I'm a car, I have lights, I know when I need to use them, what is going on, right? We were lighting in the 80s, we were lighting the sky to light our cities, then we got it wrong, then we said, oh, well, sorry, in the 90s we realized that, no, sorry, we have to light down. And now we don't need those lights. So I hope your generation, and absolutely by your city's competition, starts to look at lights in our streets, in our buildings, completely differently. This is a manifesto to say, I can turn my energy into light. That's it. It lasts 8 hours, it charges during the day, and it burns that energy. The building is extremely light, as you see. Loads are going up, not down, in order to have a lobby with no columns, no infrastructure, no foundations. You have seen the Tesla Model 3 when you go inside? No, 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 200 no's. And everything digital in that screen, right? So how many no's are you going to say to produce these biocities? No, sorry, no way, no, excuse me, no, 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 not anymore. No columns. So the energy performance of the building is extremely crucial. We are in global warming. We love Gaudí and we love Pedrera and we are very interested in this idea of nature. But the difference between this building and us is that we have north in an energy performance. We have south with another energy performance. We have east and west. And every condition has different energy diagrams. Yes, you know this. You are with me. So what if the manifesto is every skin deserves a different technology. When you are in Barcelona and you see a curtain wall, the same curtain wall, the same technology being used on the north to the south, the same solution is absolutely wrong. You know what? You want to know the percentage that this curtain wall is wrong? 320% wrong. 320% wrong. Not 3, not 30, 320. We cannot design with this waste. You are with me? You understand? Right? So What if the condition is that we have to reduce global warming? By how much do we have to reduce in your cities with biotechnology, with biodesign? Are you thinking to reduce CO2 emissions by 20%? 40%? 70%? Or 100%? And then you go net zero. What's your plan? So that was the challenge here. So we said, why don't we use a membrane that is separated to the glass, and that membrane starts to produce a condition in which the building can move the skin. When the sun hits the skin, every cushion moves. Dots close. So by doing that, you have 90% of the natural light inside, but you don't have the UV light. In Barcelona, AC is 80% the invoice of your energy in your building, 80%, yes? You know, we don't have a winter. Our winter is 2 weeks, is a joke, yeah? But all the energy bill, 80% is air conditioning. So what we have to address is to stop air conditioning, right? So that is the building, you know, it's built. We can go and visit it together. Those are the cushions I was just mentioning. But in the vertical side where we have west, the condition is different. So east is one, west is another one. This is vertical. So here, what the building is doing is that it creates a vertical cloud using nitrogen inside the layer of ETFE. Inside the cushions. Let's have a look. So we do light buildings, but heavy particles. You know, it's nitrogen here. So strong, the cushions have all the UV light inside, but I don't want, as an architect, and in a very radical way, we don't want any fog, we don't want any heat, we don't, then the building creates this vertical cloud. That's a photo, like in the middle of August, you see, shiny, translucent, it's extreme, right? We have to stop the UV light to go inside and not to use the air conditioning, right? So that's the way from the inside you start to see, you know, this kind of translucency. So it's a system. What I want you to know today is that in these bio cities, systems are going to be crucial. Don't think about projects and think about systems. Systems. So the system here, nitrogen, natural oil, particles, nitrogen goes up. Because it's extremely light, but in order that we want it to go down, we have to add some weight to the particle. So we bring natural oil as a carrier to bring gravity to that particle of nitrogen. Yeah, are you with me? Yes? And that gravity brings nitrogen down. We spend about 4,000 euros of nitrogen along all year long. For a building of 18,000 square meters is like peanuts. But it produces this incredible performance. On the other side, east, we have Arduinos that are running all these cushions, one each. So it's this idea of distributed intelligence. You see these small boxes here near every of the cushions, that's a luxometer. So instead of having a centralized sensor at the top of the building and then the sensor runs the building centralized, instead of that, we do a distributed system of sensors, 128 sensors, yes? 128 cushions, 128 decisions. When the shadow of the neighbor is in front, only the ones that have the shadow will open. When a cloud passes by, only the ones affected by the shadow of the cloud will open, right? So you don't want a decision, everybody out, everybody in, but rather one by one, yeah? So this is done using a grid, a network of Arduinos. You know Arduinos? I mean, you are in the IAAC, people are, you are all working as makers on this, and that's what it produces, no? The idea of distributed intelligence. This is really, really important for your biocities. It means to have a sensor that is measuring the amount of light on the desk of the office, and if I am the owner of the office and I want to turn the lights on, well, this sensor is saying, sorry, you have about 500 luxes on the tabletop, you don't need extra light. So the building does not allow you to turn your lights on because the building is saying you have plenty of natural light. Okay, it's radical. We need to be radical. So another thing we do as architects is the idea of monitoring. You know, have you heard about this? Yes, no? So imagine you produce the building, you fabricate the building, and then you get the key, you have the key, it's finished, nice, fantastic. You give the key to the client, and then you say, okay, thank you very much, bye. Don't you want to be during the next 1 or 2 years to see the performance of the building? Well, architects don't do. Architects, designers, give the key and they leave. Well, it's when the machine is going to start running. Do you want to stay or do you want to go? Sorry, what's the answer? Do you want to stay or do you want to go? Do you want to see your machine in performance? Do you want to see your building performing or not? Probably yes, no? You want to stay there. So we have a contract, like you have a design contract, but then you have a monitoring contract so that you stay and you check your balance. The engineers told me that the light was going to do this. Well, my lumens are doing that. Oh, I'm better than the engineering, or I'm lower than the engineering. So that's what you do. You check your outcomes. And that's when you get the phone call of the client here of the consortium, who sent me a phone call saying, your invoice, your power invoice of this building is 6, and the power invoice of the building nearby is 100. The neighbor is sending 100 CO2 emissions, you are sending 6. 100, 6. You understand this? If you are under 9, you are a net zero building. Net zero is not zero, is like 9%, yes? That's a net zero building, a building that when everybody is doing 100, we are doing 5, 3, 2, 6, yeah? Yes, you understand the huge difference, yeah? Okay, so again, think about systems. The media city is a system. You have to know about photovoltaics, you have to know about green roofs, you have to collect the rainwater, you have to know about birds and creating the right nesting for those birds. You have to know about nitrogen, 128 Arduinos, you have to know about geothermal, you have to send water from the air conditioning to the sea of Barcelona with district cooling, you have to cool that water comes in and doesn't produce CO2 emissions either because it's cooling the little bit of fresh air inside the space using that cooling. It's not about inputs and outputs, it's about systems, yeah? You understand how complex buildings are becoming and your biocities as well? So this is, again, the final photo with my family here, one of the few first days that this was finished. So I'm gonna show you another building. This is in Zaragoza, the Expo 2008. And here we were working with the idea of salt, of a pavilion of salt. Again, experiments, no? If you want to embrace nature, do experiments. Determination. acoustic waves. So acoustic waves, you know, waves, no? Acoustic waves and salt. So you have gravity and acoustic waves. What happens if you have waves and salt? Well, you start to produce these landscapes, you see? Looks like nothing happens, but you start to produce something that emerges. Complexity emerges and some sort of structures start to emerge. Out of these structures, you can zoom in and get very close, and then there is architecture, nature architecture, right? Something starts to emerge out of this accident of sound waves and salt. But if you focus closer, you will be able to target this idea that maybe the building is about salt. Let's try. So what if our body, you know, our body is breathing, right? We breathe, we burn energy, and our skin, which seems to be a skin, actually is very porous and produces water and produces salt, right? And we breathe. So what if the building has to do that? What if the building breathes? And by breathing, there is no air condition. Think systems. Systems are built out of components. This component is ETFE, fiberglass, steel structure, and nozzles. Nozzles that collect water from the river of Zaragoza, add salt to that water, and start to breathe. It starts to produce this water and salt. Let me show you this quick. We do lots of experiments with performative models. I suggest you to work with performative models. What happens? You start to produce these models, these 3D, the idea of a skin, and then from here you go parametric, and then they use, again, no, using now Grasshopper and so on, you could go into the idea of they're all the same, but they're not the same, but they are all the same, but not the same, you know? So this is a fiberglass skin. It's 2 millimeters of fiberglass. Then there is 5 centimeters of high density thermal styrofoam, and then again 2 millimeters of fiberglass. That produces a sandwich of 6 centimeters and 4 millimeters. So it's right this, yes? And they are extremely light. When we were here in the factory, this element is from here to the middle of the room, and two people were carrying this, shoop, shoop, extremely light, yes? Do you remember the idea of lightness I mentioned before? Lightness, yeah? So we need salt, we need to bring salt into the system. We need to produce extremely light skin, because if it's extremely light skin, then it will be extreme light structure. This is 40 meters diameter. The media ICT fits inside this dome, okay, that we are building here. And you see the bars on the very top are homes are extremely efficient in terms of reality, strength, and load. So you start to see, you see this crane in between that. That is the size of the warehouse. Fast. That's how you get to the dome. And by doing this, then the next layer is the skin. So the skin is, again, two people placing some modules, chup, 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 mechanical fasten, extremely fast, extremely light, 20 meters high. And there you have this other layer of the ETFE cushions. I've never done cushions as big as these ones. These are about 12 meters diameter, 16 meters diameter. But that is the light. They work at 300 Pascal pressure. They can go up to 1000 Pascal pressure. So wind loads are 180 kilometer per hour loads. So we are like three times the loads of wind and snow. The building was the only building in this expo that was talking about water, but that was not using air conditioning in the inside. And the way it was doing it was because the building was thinking, what should I do today? What are the temperatures? And depending on the temperature, the building was sweating. What is the salt? Well, it's cloudy. There's no need of salt. It's not sweating. It's not a warm day. Oh, but they came to film the salt. Yeah, but nature is like this. Nature is like this. It's not an image. It's a performance, right? Come back when there is a lot of sun. So another project in San Sebastian. I'm talking about projects that are extremely aligned, I believe. Tell me if not, but I believe they are aligned to what bio cities are looking for. Thank you, that's so nice. We are water, this is water, good. So talking about water, you know, San Sebastian is a culture, is a Basque culture, very related to the idea of the sea, the idea of the waves, the idea, it's embedded in their idea of fishing, the idea of their urban planning. So we were asked by the mayor to produce, to think about a project that could discuss this condition of San Sebastian in the future of the city, a sort of project that starts to address what is the city, where the city wants to go. So it's in a moment in which you are also thinking in your competition projects. So the first thing we did were, again, experiments. This is Maya, and we are working with Maya to operate with part of the water. This is a sea against the sea. So Maya allows us to operate as a system, produces space between the waves. Now the waves go backwards. So animating particles controls space, time. You see now how the sea is producing this game. Kind of architecture of particles that we are pushing forward. But these particles are steam, are water, and the water is used by this is a nozzle that is a steel structure nozzle that breaks. LA, we were there. So what if the project is a system and the project is fiberglass structure? You have the water of the ocean, you have the fiberglass, but then you have nozzles, and every nozzle has an IP address. This is something when we were with Vicente doing the media house about the idea of Internet of Things. So it was very important to think that information is in our objects. So why can we not have on each nozzle an IP address, right? So we can. And by doing that and having speakers and having sensors and having other technologies that start to link the idea of our community, San Sebastian, and the ocean. What if this place can become a gathering space where these two cultures get together, right? And it has a dialogue to the Cursal of Rafael Moneo, where it is built out of glass, and we are building architecture out of the waves using that water and those nozzles. Yeah, imagine the condition in which you have a wave inside waves. Is that a building? Is that architecture? Is that landscape? What is it? And by doing that, with the help of Technalia, we did a strong research on what is the energy that our oceans can produce for our cities, right? Oceans are here producing energy for our cities, but they are not linked together. So we can have a grid of buoys that are floating, and their movement produce the energy of our system. The same way our structure will not fight the forces, but will follow the wind loads in front as a surfer, as Javier Peña, who's a faculty here. The energy will follow, no, the movement of the energy. So this is something that is going to be constantly, and that's how engineers manipulate and produce their thickness. But at the same time, because there is IP addresses, we can send data to every of these IP addresses and produce the day of the blue cross, or we can play music in the wave. So the water of the wave and music of Brian Eno are together. Or I can have water here as a door and water on the top as a cloud is kind of a place to produce artwork. So architecture, and I think the biocities also should embrace this idea that architecture is a platform. If it is a system, can be a platform, right? And then you have other players like agents, musicians, people doing code, that start to play and operate in your building, in your cloud, in your landscape, in your structure, in your system. Yeah? Are you with me? Yeah? Are you water? Yes. Eh? Okay. So here we ask Lesias to play music for our project. very creamy, quite something. We got a team of people from Taipei visiting the Media ICT, Far Glory. Anybody from Taipei? Taiwan? Anybody Taiwan, Taipei? Not this year in the IAAC? No? There's always someone from Taiwan in the IAAC. No, not this time. Okay. So we built this project. It's the first green residence house tower housing project in Taipei. It was strong because we implemented a lot of these ideas on systems, and the skin is a ceramic skin. We have technology. It was like the first time we were able in Taipei. That's what they told us, was the first time that they were able to have wind turbines, the first kind of green roof, first photovoltaics, kind of first time to implement this, first time they gave this permit. So that's what they told us. And it was very important for us, this idea of skin, of complexity, of producing ceramics. They are used to fabricate granite panels that get attached to the steel, to the construction. Everything is, again, very heavy and so on. But imagine you are in Barcelona with a 3D model producing these ceramics, digitally fabricated with Kumeya, extruded here in Granollers. And these things, these elements, this very much a craftsmanship from Granollers, it starts to be organized, parametrized, with parametric design, and then using Excel files to do the packaging, and then all the work that need to be sent. And we were sending to Taipei these elements. We were grateful and extremely happy to be able to get a LEED certificate there. So again, the first time, and that's what they say, and that's what we believe. So again, with your BioCities, think about how to link craftsmanship with your projects, right? Craftsmanship and your projects, yeah? So a quick presentation or very quick summary of what you remember. The So it was moved to Valladolid, it was implemented. We did a new scheme for the project. Again, this idea of parametric design, they're all the same, but they're not the same. This time was built by a factory here in Lleida, IASO, and we were able to design a lot of the furniture, the interior condition, the acoustic layers, and it's used as a cultural place so that it hosts several events that go from food to sports, fashion. It's very devoted to the community that operate there. So it's really, really fantastic. Think for a moment that your project, now a system, has no boundaries. It means that we had to have a system inside the sea, inside the river of Valladolid, that would bring oxygen and oxygenize the water of the river. We also implemented wind turbines on the bridge of Valladolid. We also implemented a new landscape on the riverside. And about 2 years later, we started to see neighbors doing kayaking in front of our building because they believed that now the river was good. And there was this moment of like the same way Barcelona discovered the seaside and we open the city to our Mediterranean Sea, Valladolid is opening to this river. Rivers are, in your cities, are wind turbines. When there is a river, there is a wind turbine, possibly, yeah? So where do you place your wind turbines? Not on buildings, but on the river, because that is the spine of your wind turbines. Yeah. So the wind turbines are there, they produce the energy of the building. We introduce the idea of electric car, electric mobility, green roofs, and so on and so on. Yeah. That's how it looks by night. All LED lights, and that is the energy that we store during the day out of the wind turbines. Yeah. Another quick reaction is that you have to be activists. You have to be architects, but also activists. And Vicente and I, we were talking and having these incredible creative conversations about Jeremy Rifkin back, I think, in 2002 or 2003. Because I published the Villanours in the New York Times, their office reached out to us and they invite us to do a workshop in, tell me a country where you would like to do a workshop of green activism and green thinking and green cities and green buildings and net zero. Tell me a country, say one. Quickly. Switzerland, yes, okay. Why not, no, fantastic. Or Denmark, or, you know, or Germany, or, well, the call was Texas. Yeah. It's like Houston. You know. Jeremy, don't you think we should start a workshop in Denmark, you know? Let's just start less difficult, and then we succeed, and then we go for, no, we must start by the worst case. So Texas, back then, this is 2010, was the worst case, right? Uranium, coal, oil, like the whole thing. But on that workshop, I learned something. If you work as a team, everybody in a collective intelligence approach, we were fighting against the French lobby to build a nuclear power plant. And we were fighting against the Japanese lobby to build a nuclear power plant. The city of Houston had $8 billion, or like $8,000 million, to build two nuclear power plants, and they were going for it. And here we are, this group, talking about green roofs, net zero buildings, wind turbines, turn your public buildings, make your streets, reuse all buildings. Can you imagine? In a U-shaped table and fighting with Excel files. Images, not like these images now. So we were able to stop the construction of one of the nuclear power plants, and the mayor decided that, yes, let's spend 4,000 in one, but let's spend 4,000 in investing in green energy in Texas, in Houston. Quite a victory, no? Quite like boom. After 5 days of fighting, we got $4,000 million for Houston for green energy. Yeah. So many of the ideas we share then have made Texas this. This is not Denmark, this is Texas now. Texas is the number one state in the United States using wind turbines. They are ahead of the game. Not because of us on that workshop, probably. Or maybe yes, or maybe we were just a seat. But think about these bio cities as change agents. You are change agents in these projects. And there is a lobby there. Don't think that, well, I am in the IAAC, it's a bubble, you know, it's a fantastic school to produce knowledge. But there is a lobby out there that you are gonna shake. Yes, you are aware of this, yes? Yes or no? No? Well, start to be aware, yes? Architects as activists, yeah? Okay, and to finish, I want to, because I very much support IAAC. To me, it's my home. IAAC is all I have learned here. And so I wanted very much to show you what we are doing in Valencia, in the Casa Forum. I think one of a very important person from the team, Salvador, is joined right there. Yes, all the questions to Salvador, please. Thank you, Salvador, for coming tonight. And so this started with a letter of invitation to compete, you know, in the middle of August, you know, one of these days that you are in the office, but you are not supposed to be in the office because it's the middle of August. We're in Spain. We do a break in August, in the summer. But we got this letter and let's compete. Why not? Well, why not? Why? Because the challenge was to do a building, a museum, inside a Calatrava building. Okay? You see the challenge? Retrofitting a generation of architects who are very important to us. Architects like Calatrava has opened a lot of fields, a lot of highways, a lot of territories, a lot of spaces for exploration. And we are very grateful to that. But interestingly enough, we are now looking at these buildings and we have to retrofit, reactivate, recondition, re-empower these buildings. This is like me saying to you, you are the next generation coming, and I hope very much so. I thought, is this recording? Are you recording the lecture? Yes. So I want to say it because it's recording. So I want you to be the generation that comes to the media ICT and retrofits the skin of the building. Are you with me? You have to be able to come, take these nuts down and build over us. That's what is called retrofit. Yes? How many people want to do this? Okay, one, two, three. Oh, there is some brave people. Are you sure you want to do it? Great, great, great. So imagine I go to this building, Agora building in Calatrava, empty building, completely empty, and I am there for 4 hours, kind of lost in this massive building. It's like a dinosaur skeleton, or it's like a warehouse, or it's like an empty body. Yeah? So I was starting to imagine, how could the program take shape inside? So what sort of cells, what sort of organs, stomach, brain, lungs, could be inside this building? What sort of nature, forest, cloud, could happen inside this empty space? And what sort of parametric design are we going to do to elaborate a very complex landscape? What sort of democratic space can we build inside a public land with public funds in a public building with now a private foundation coming in to do artwork inside, right? So who could be the builder of this fantastic and powerful initiative of La Caixa Foundation? Yeah, this is the Caixa Forum, is the number 9 in Spain, is the last building of Caixa Forums in Spain to build this network. The network brings culture to the cities, brings exhibitions from key museums like the British Museum, like the MoMA in New York, like El Louvre or Pompidou. So top museums as a network, doing exhibitions and important performance workshops. It's a very important network in our society to bring culture to us. So an intersection, what sort of performance will this space need or will this space do? I know the space is protecting me from snow, from rain, from wind loads, but I have the sun going in. That's an interesting, no? Someone is doing a dome and we are inside, protected inside this fantastic place. So in the competition, we know what we are good at. We know our pots of knowledge. We know the institutions we are working with. We were building the El Bulli Foundation. So we are building El Bulli Foundation. We were finishing El Bulli. We have Fundación La Caixa. The builder is Sorigue. Sorigue won the competition to build this project. So Sorigue is right now building. And Sorigue has a foundation. Sorigue is very committed to the role of innovation. Sorigue is also participating here in the IAAC. So there is all these networks, right, of innovation. And then instead of having the architect role, as Calatrava generation would do, the architect star role, let's put it this way, instead of that, we have this flat organization, completely flat, where you have a designer like Simon Taylor, you have a ceramist like Tony Cumella, you have an artist like Frederic Amat, you have Salvador from Art Devils being the architect, the technical architect of the project, you have a collaboration with Javier Peña from Expiral, and you have musicians, and you have code experts, and you have biologists, and you have a structure like Agustín Obiols from BAC. So all these people, Luis Borunda designing the code for this exoskeleton that the cloud is, as makers. So when you start thinking about your biocities, don't think about them as you are the solo author, but see them as this maker, this network of makers, yeah, that you are working with, yeah, that you are part of. It's good news. We are not alone. You understand? It's good news. On top, you see the competition, and then on the very top, the impact that this is going to have in society. So these are the first renders of the competition. You start to see the use of CLT, ceramics, fiberglass, some innovations and some patents of other projects that come to play here. You see that the brain is the place where the curators and the artists gather. In when you go to MACBA, you don't know where the curators are, you don't know where the artists are, you don't know where the office of the director is, because it's in another building. Here we want transparency with the directors and the team. The library is where the books of the other exhibitions, you know, it's kind of our roots. And it's very important that the books kind of emerge and produce a certain knowledge so that the decisions of the curators are out of that knowledge. In the program, it was requested to have a restaurant and a museum. Well, if you do a museum here and a restaurant there, it means food is not culture, right? You are with me? If this is a museum and this is a restaurant, then this is not culture, but food is culture. So there's no restaurant. Everything is part of the museum because food is culture. The space of pedagogy, the space of education, the space of families and kids, many times behind the stairs at the end of the corridor, or I really forgot this space. Well, here not, they are the main space. They are the core of the museum. They are the center of the building. And they are in a cloud. And the auditorium, which is a landscape of cardboard. And this is what the competition was looking like. So again, the use of movies allows you to show systems, allows you to show components, allows you to show escape. Competition, we are the winners. This happens, I don't know, Vicente, happens once every 10 years. You know, it's like in 2011, we did the Media ICT, and then here we are in 2020. So, yeah, 9 years, 10 years. And here we are. This is the president of the Valencia community, extremely important. The adjunct director general, Lisa Duran. Leading the foundation, Caixa Foundation, and Giro was the general director back in this moment. Again, the cloud plays an important role in this layout, in this landscape. Of course, to build things like this, about 16 to 18 million euros as a retrofitting, right? It's extremely complicated because you have an existing body, and we had to do something inside without doing foundations because there is already foundations, right? So again, the idea of extreme light parametric design again. And if you have really thin steel plates and steel structure, and you want to collaborate with CLT, that's an incredible collaboration. Steel structure, extremely thin, and CLT. But then you have a problem of fire on the steel structure, not on the CLT, but on the steel structure. And what if we don't use paint, but we use timber to protect our steel against fire? Timber protecting steel. You see, it's like, one moment. Timber protecting steel against fire. Yeah, if the thickness of the timber is enough for the minutes that you need, that's the idea, no? That is the system. So that's what you get. You get an interesting steel structure protected by timber. So we need to produce more buildings using timber, because if we do, we will produce forestation. Think systems, don't think buildings, think systems. We need forestation? Yes. Well, timber. That's how you link the two. Yeah? Okay. So now it's starting to look like this now. Thank you, Salvador, for all the work you are doing there every week. We are bringing innovation from another project where we have the patent. We have this patent on fiberglass. It's an exoskeleton of fiberglass, again, 3 millimeters of fiberglass. And we are using this as scaffolding, as form finding, as structure, and in three different places, different geometries. The system operates with modules. It operates with a combination of fiberglass and timber, again. The timber is, so we have to engineer every truck, because of the CO2 emissions of the transportation. And this is how you produce this palette, no? This atlas of solutions. And from here you go into fiberglass and timber together, and that's how you produce this extremely strong structure. The structure collapses together and it starts to become this membrane. So these are Frei Otto membranes at the end, but no foundation, no concrete, no mass, no reinforcement, no thickness. Again, sorry, your concrete is not the business and the steel is not your business tonight. Sorry. So here we go, extremely light surfaces. And when we want to produce a thermal condition, a performance, we are going back to ceramics. Ceramics are extremely good in UV lights because of the smalt. Ceramics have energy embodied because they have been at 800 degrees inside. So these ceramics start to produce. But for the first time here, we are connecting parametric design and fabrication of every tile. So the diameter of the tiles, which are leaves, this comes from this idea of forest, of leaves, of seasons. Why don't we do seasonable architecture? If we want our architecture to connect to nature, we have to do seasonable architecture, right? So the idea of time-based. And this is what it produces. Every geometry has a different diameter. You know the work of Gaudí, you know the trencadís. You have to break all the ceramics to adjust, no, to the geometry. Well, here, like our cells, they don't break, they mutate, right? So the thickness and the diameter is related to the geometry of the surface. Yeah. And Salvador will confirm, I was here with the team making this possible, and to see someone who by hand plays the different diameters according to the geometry is extremely beautiful. This idea of nature and natural performance and natural behavior and the idea of flow, the Bauman, no, liquid time, we are really, really happy about this. Domes are terrible for acoustics, right? Domes, if you go to La Pedrera and you are at the very top, they are terrible for acoustics. the sound travels through domes. So we had to regenerate, and this is together with the University Polytechnica of Catalonia, where we have developed a patent, again, where this ceramic has a membrane inside. The layer outside is very thin, but the acoustic is kept inside. So the wave goes in, but doesn't go out. It gets trapped inside. So it has a porosity of the waves, yeah? But it's done by the use, I think it's about 4 centimeters high. Yeah? So it's an absorbing ceramic warm tile without using smalt. We produce this for a house in Agua Blava with Robin, and this patent now is used here. And the innovation that is used in this project is also producing royalties as a network. Here you see the patent, fantastic. The cloud is a new project for us, is innovative. Caixa Foundation is risking, is investing, is financing, is really supporting creative work and innovative work. We know Caixa from the corporate world, from the banking, but if you go back to how much culture the Caixa Foundation has done, I was now in my library the other day going back to this small book of Leveus Woods, these drawings of Leveus Woods, like very important in our 90s, and the logo was Caixa Foundation. No? Yo, Foundation did this. So they have been really, really supportive. So great client to work with. It's very difficult to manage. It's extremely complex to produce these steel structures with curve in the 2 year of COVID. The very top of the cloud is salt, which is sand, which is glass. So it's recycled glass. We are working with this company, Sto, producing a continuous surface that helps thermically against UV lights and also produces this continuous surface. We have inside we have ETFE. Again, we are using this for skylights. And the innovation that we are also bringing here is this idea of a 3D printed exoskeleton. We believe that robots have to be on site, and we have to use robots to do on-site robotics, right? We started this with Technalia here in the Media ICT with cable robotics back in 2009, 2010, 2011. So right now, this is the code that Luis Borunda is working, and this is a work that is going on at Virginia Tech, developed at Virginia Tech in the School of Architecture and Design. Code is basically looking for an exoskeleton that works as a structure, as a skin, but also resists fire. So we are using new smart composites that use ceramics, particles of ceramics, molecular ceramics inside composites. And they are making our, again, no, this network of makers. We are partnering here with Manuel from Nagami. Amazing work. This is an accelerated movie of the work that they are developing. So code from Virginia Tech, fabrication from Nagami, builder, Sorige, and Caixa Foundation as one, no, as together. So again, no, the prototype was shown there in the steel structure. So we are in this moment of approvals and everything is moving forward. I'm showing this image because, you know, we are the number one cause of global warming. This is true. We are, I mean, yes or no, guys? This is a big yes. I want to hear the yes in Facebook. Yes. Can we say yes? Like, that's a very shy yes. It's not like I'm responsible of this. Can you say yes?
Yes.
So what if we are the solution? We are the problem. So, oh, they say yes, good. So we are the problem, but maybe we are the solution, no? Because if we are the problem, really, we, then we are the solution. That's fantastic, no? So what if we are the solution in global warming, but what if we understand that the number one industry in the world is construction? The number one economy in the world is not China, is not Europe, is not America, is construction. The biggest GDP in the world is construction, is not tourism, is not real estate. I know some architects in India you want to do real estate, but that's not the business. The business is construction. During the 2.5 years that we've been in COVID, these people have been inside this space, working all the time, getting infected, following all the health and safety protocols. So they're really heroes. We are heroes being here in person. That's how I see it, yeah? Okay? So again, one more of these innovations, which is gonna be a cupboard skin under development right now. And what if we start to understand how air flows? Air is essential to us. I think air in your biocities is gonna be a very strong driver. So that's what happens inside this building. You start to accumulate heat, layers of heat at the very top, and you start to bring fresh air from the bottom into that. And that's how you produce this kind of flow and dynamics. Nobody sees this. This is hidden, but that's what is happening, right? And so we are the architects of these flows. And we are programming and coding and sensoring surface, temperature, humidity, windows, screens, doors, smoke and particles suspended to collaborate in this kind of orchestra, no? of performance. So those are starting to be the as-built of the project, which we are getting there. We are targeting LEED. It would be a LEED museum in Europe. It's important to have an art museum LEED. Of course, there is a lot of press. There is a lot of impact because it's kind of one first time to retrofit a building of this as a new generation, but it's the first one, you know? The first one of many. And you have great examples in Chicago of people of our generation retrofitting modern buildings to produce that. In Virginia Tech, there is a group of students who are working on this cloud, who are in the studio of masters. I wanted them to, because they are in Zoom, I wanted them to be with you today in this moment. So IAAC and Virginia Tech, you are guys together, both universities together. And it's a moment that starts to be crucial. We have to finish this construction in June. 21st of June is the opening day, where the politics will be there and the building will be open. We are working really, really hard for those dates and the economy of the building and the cost, and you know, resources are going up, companies are becoming, they're broke, but we have to continue helping, producing jobs and moving forward, yes? So 1 minute more? I have 1 more minute? Yes? Okay, so this is my last message. We have to grow our me. Where is the me? Me, here, me. We have to grow our me. You understand what I mean? Authorship, you, not your group, you. Your creative thinking, your sensibility, your expertise, your knowledge, your reality, your background, your culture, your portfolio, your city, your skills, your sensibility, your hobbies, your me. Grow me. You understand? Grow self-sufficiency. Be an author. Be mad. Be disruptive. Me. Me. I am being me now. Yes? Okay, understood me? But if we don't build we, school, community, makers, networks, neighbors, family, tribe, friends, relationships, relationships, team. There's no we. Yes? If you want a we, you need a movement for the we. Yes? So I think we have been looking a lot at me, or maybe not enough, but we need to grow the me and the we. In this Green New Deal, we will be successful as a movement, as we, if we grow our me's. If we have the diversity that we need, the Tim Burton diversity that we need, the Edward Scissorhands that we need, me's, to produce we. Yeah? Thank you very much.
Okay. Good. Okay. I understood that. Is there any question from the audience? Yeah. Can you check also if there are some questions from Facebook? And yeah, okay.
Hello. Oh, thank you for your lecture. Very, very interesting. My question is regarding the financial aspect of this sort of architecture.
Yes.
Is it substantially more expensive to do this sort of design? Is it more expensive to buy the equipment to do the construction? And is there really enough savings in materials to offset that?
Absolutely. That's exactly right. When I won the Media ICT building, I went to this meeting, you know, like it's the city of Barcelona, it's the mayor of Barcelona, it's the agency of the mayor of Barcelona. Enric, you know, you have 2,200 euros per square meter cost to build this. Okay. Okay. So I went back to the studio and then we discussed what is 2,200 euros. And checking the market, the buildings around were built with 1,300. Right? And Zaha builds with Zaha Hadid builds with 6,000. So if you are building one off, you are at 4,000, 5,000, 6,000. If you want to produce a revolution in the market cost of construction, you don't build at 2,000. That would be wrong. You understand? So what I said to the mayor office was, we are not going to accept the 2,200 because we will not compete. We are saying to the rest, do a net zero building, and they are going to tell me, yes, but you have 2,000 and we have 1,300. So I went down and I said, we are going to spend only 1,300 to send a message to the market that you can do net zero buildings, not at 20% more money, but at the same cost. The killer app is to do it at the same cost. That's the real revolution. Do you agree? So when you don't do a building out of concrete or steel, but you do it extremely light, normally you would do $4.5 million was the cost of the foundation in the Media ICT. But since we hung the building and we did this structure so light, the cost of the foundation was 2.5. So just by the foundations, we save 1.5 million euros. How much was the cost of the ETFE? 1.3. Where Enric gets the monies, which is your question, by not pouring concrete in the foundations. Can you imagine? So you have to be extremely efficient where you spend your money. And to get to net zero is possible if you do a lot of no. So the monies are there. You don't need 20% more. Yeah?
Great question. We have a question on Zoom, if I may, by Sana Zarey. She says, thank you for this insightful presentation. I would like to ask about how strong are the biocity structures against natural diseases or disasters, like earthquakes and or storms, as they are being built very light. Thanks again.
Yes, we learned this in Japan. When you produce a concrete structure, any little movement, clack, produces a crack, and then the whole building collapses. Movement is good. Movement is good. Not too much, but control movement is good. Every joint of the glass of the media ICT has a rubber so that the glass moves in one way and the steel structure moves in another way. So my answer is against tornadoes, earthquakes, seismic zones like Taipei is a seismic zone, we have achieved light structures that support, because they move extremely well. On top, ETFE can go up to 1,000 Pascal pressure. The heavy hurricanes are 200 Pascal pressure. So actually, to protect our buildings against a hurricane and so on, we did a project at OECS in the Caribbean where ETFE was used as an airbag, as a protection to the building itself. So yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Go light, and we are learning this from Bucky Fuller. We are learning this from Frayoto. There's very good examples out there. Yeah. Thank you. Great question.
More questions?
Salvador says goodbye.
One is saying bye-bye.
Yes. See you Wednesday.
Okay, guys. So
no more questions? No more questions?
No more questions, everything is clear. I mean,
they have it clear.
After saying that this is not more expensive and this will receive a tornado, they believe everything that you say. So yeah, everything is good. More questions? No?
About the real estate in India, I think there were some comments. Go for a question, please. Yes.
Yes. No more questions, Enric. There are no questions, there are no questions. I'm okay. Sorry. Congratulations again. You know, I swear, I think that Calatrava is really sick. And I swear not to enter ever in a Calatrava, in this Calatrava building, because I am from Valencia. And all of this was kind of a craziness of someone, both politicians of architects. But in this very special case, I will close my eyes when I look around. And I will try to enter to your building, because I think that this is an amazing experimentation and an amazing project.
I want to say that there is artists in Valencia, Inma Femenia, who are working inside the project. And if you check online, you'll see their work. It's a project that wants to have architects and artists working together. You know, sometimes museums cannot be touched, cannot be screwed, cannot be anchored. But on the contrary, you know, there is a synergy between the work of Inma. She's doing an art cancel, and I don't want to reveal more, but you're all welcome to come to Valencia and visit the construction site if you think it's interesting.
And after July 21st to visit.
After June, exactly. Thank after you. June.
Good. Thank you, guys. Thank you also
thank
for the
you
people online.
The team. Thank you.
Bye.